Everyone loves a good dog. The internet is full of cats. Oh, and also furries. And half of all children's cartoons seem to be about anthropomorphic animals. People really seem to enjoy animals in their fiction and their political commentary. So it is expected that a lot of games feature animals as their protagonists. Hey there, gamerinos and gamerinas. Welcome to Unicorn Storm. This is Rady, and today I want to present you my favorite four-legged fighters, the most adventurous animals, and the most brave and beautiful beasts. This video will mainly feature my top 10 picks with some honorable mentions sprinkled in between, but this won't be a rigid list with bolted-on placements, though of course the game at the top of the list is better than the one at the bottom. And I present my picks from the bottom upwards. As for the rules, no virtual pets. I only want actual games. Action games, adventures, RPGs, everything is fine as long as you play an actual or an anthropomorphic animal. But I will rate how well the animal is implemented thematically and mechanics-wise. So, an alien cat riding a motorcycle and running around at the speed of sound won't appear on this list. And just for fairness' sake, and to not have one developer dominate this list, I will only allow one animal mascot character per studio. So, without further ado, let's take a look at my 10 favorite animal adventures. Overgrowth. This game is jank. So you're playing as a human-sized bipedal rabbit who beats up other rabbits, and dogs, and wolves. For the most part, the game handles its lapine hero quite well. Since he's a rabbit, he gets incredibly fast and can jump ludicrously high and far. In fights, he mostly attacks with his legs and feet. He even makes use of a drop kick. Sounds like a recipe for an awesome animal adventurer. And the game would be higher on my list were it not for its execution. Movement, while a bit floaty, works fine most of the time, but tight platforming and short jumps can be really finicky, especially since the player character might just drop off a ledge, bounce off a wall, or break his neck while holding onto a ledge. Levels are huge and sprawling, but you only have to dispose of a handful of enemies in each, so most of the level is an unused barren wasteland. Combat, while fine in theory, controls really weird. You kinda lock onto enemies and face them automatically, and you have to hold down on the attack button to auto-attack whenever you're in range, and you can control the kind of attack by moving in a specific direction, and you can also deflect enemy attacks with the right timing, and during one-on-one brawls this works quite well, but as soon as weapons come into play, or you have to fight against groups or a much stronger enemy, it all breaks down, because enemies attack erratically. Controlling the camera becomes worse and worse the more enemies you fight simultaneously, and moving around makes it even harder to control. Weapon attacks are hard to read and even harder to deflect, and when you yourself are carrying a weapon, your window to counter seems to be even smaller, though you can at least block weapon strikes. Maybe I just suck at this game, but all this jank made some of the challenges frustrating as hell. It still has a very unique way to portray a playable animal character, and with a few tweaks, this kind of game could be really awesome. So it deserves a spot on this list. Ghost of a Tale. This game is just so damn cute and still maintains a bit of a dark tone. Kinda like Mrs. Brisby. You play as Tilo, a mouse minstrel in a fantasy kingdom inhabited by rodents. He and his wife had been captured by soldiers of the Red King, and now he must escape his prison and find a way to rescue his wife. All characters in this game are animals, and while they do have some quirks related to their species, they pretty much behave like humans. The murine theme only extends to the size of objects and environments, or how common objects are just repurposed to fit the size of a mouse. As a mouse, Tilo doesn't stand a chance in a fight against even one rat, so he has to be stealthy, disguise himself, or hide from his enemies. The game is visually and in the use of its theme very much like a fairy tale. It might not represent the little rodents all too well, but they do add to the beautiful design. Moss is very similar in this aspect. While the animals look the part, they just don't behave like you would expect from them. Here, the little mouse Quill fights with a sword against beetles who slash or shoot at her. She doesn't live inside the walls of a human household, she lives in a Smurf-like village deep within the forest. The world is still a piece of beauty, full of mystery. And it's a nice touch that Quill, since she can't really speak our language, converses with the player by sign language. Both are good games that profit from the marine theme. They just don't do too much with it, gameplay-wise. Chameleon Twist. Mascot platformers were a staple of early mainstream console gaming, and in the late 90s it was all about 3D platformers with iconic protagonists. Be it Crash, or Jack and his friend Dexter, Cow the Kangaroo, or the adorable Dragon Spyro, be it Frogger or Croc, or the DK Crew. Most of these games hadn't really had their mechanics built around the specific strengths and weaknesses of their protagonists. But sometimes, some of the playable animals were able to use some of their real-world counterparts' abilities. Enter Chameleon Twist. In these games, you play as an anthropomorphic, well, chameleon, more or less. The design is a lot better in the second game. Both games make use of a chameleon's most iconic ability, the color-changing. Wait, what? Yeah, I mean, you can choose a color at the start of the game, so I guess that counts. But aside from basic running and jumping, the thing you'll do most in this game is using your very long tongue to grab enemies and onto objects. You can catch smaller enemies with your tongue and hold them in your mouth to use them as projectiles against other enemies. You can also grab onto walls and poles and the like to pull yourself towards it. By doing that, you can cross greater gaps than you can by jumping, so you have to master this move to get through the increasingly difficult platforming challenges. You can also wrap your tongue around poles and fling yourself round and round, even hold onto another pole in mid-flight to change your direction. Being able to use the tongue abilities efficiently has a bit of a learning curve, but it's very rewarding to slowly master it and get to do some really neat tricks. And well, this chameleon is way better with his tongue than Yuka will ever be. Okami. If you're familiar with the Zelda series, then you know that one time Link was chasing chickens as a wolf, well, while also trying to save the world. What an incredible and unique idea. Too bad that Capcom beat Nintendo to the punch by a few months, with their own Zelda clone featuring a wolf as the protagonist. They even included a talkative sidekick. In Okami, you play as Amaterasu, the great goddess of the morning sun who came to Earth in the form of a white wolf to save the world from the evil eight-headed serpent Orochi. Since you play as a wolf, you can't actually talk to people. You can listen to them, and sometimes, when the story demands it, your sidekick speaks in your stead. Sometimes people are irritated or even afraid of you, but most of the time they don't really mind. Amaterasu is beautifully animated, be it when running around or even using her distinctive weapons in combat. But the mechanics aren't really designed around the limitations of the Lupine protagonist. Thematically and visually, the game works around you being a wolf. Amaterasu carries items and holds her weapons in her mouth. She runs on all fours and paddles around in the water. She growls when she's angry and she yawns when she's bored. She can dig holes to find treasure and she can bark. But everything Amaterasu isn't physically able to do is done by godly powers or by her sidekick Isun. Since a wolf can't really plant or throw bombs, they magically appear by the power of the magic brush. Since she can't talk to people, Isun asks all the relevant questions. The game didn't need to have an animal protagonist to work, but the wolf was implemented quite well and gave the story a lot of charm and personality. Cat Tales is a game about cats that even features a cat creator. You play as a house cat that got abandoned for reasons, and now you have to survive in the wild by hunting, fighting off rival cats, and joining a community of friendly cats with their own village, jobs, and economy. Yeah, no, this game isn't really on the realistic side. It's more like what if cats behaved like humans? You can buy and sell items, take requests from the message board, or go mining for gems. But you can also hunt for prey and forage all kinds of plants to keep yourself fed and heal your wounds. You can fight off cats from rival clans to claim more territory for your own clan, and you have to present gifts to magical altars to awake a spirit of nature. By hunting, fighting, foraging, and the most important thing for any cat, sleeping, you gain XP to spend on your core abilities or to learn new skills. This game isn't a realistic cat simulator, but the feline theme is strongly woven into the mechanics, whether it be stalking prey, fighting for dominance, or presenting gifts to other cats. I actually was a bit surprised about how much fun this has been. Tokyo Jungle. In a world where humankind has mysteriously vanished, Tokyo has become home to ferocious beasts, and they must hunt, eat, flee, and mate to survive. You can play as cute little pets or wild animals, as hunter or as prey, and you have to roam the abandoned and overgrown streets of Tokyo to gather food and claim your territory. As a herbivore, you have to find plants to feed yourself, and you have to be on the lookout for predators and hide from them. You should avoid fighting whenever possible and use your, hopefully, superior speed and the tall grass that's growing everywhere to escape your pursuers. As a carnivore, you have to stalk your prey and kill it quickly and clean to not give it a chance to escape. But you have to always be vigilant for stronger predators who don't like you waltzing into their territory. When you're not hunting or being hunted, you can find a mate to produce offspring because your animal character doesn't live forever. If you don't want to end your run early, you have to sire pups or kittens or whatever all of them are called before you turn 15. Your children inherit some of your abilities like bonus health or strength, so over the generations your character becomes increasingly stronger. The gameplay is very arcadey. Every animal just has a basic attack and a pounce attack. They all can run and jump and hide. Some may be slightly faster and some are stronger, but they all pretty much play the same. It's still a different experience to play as a herbivore than playing as a carnivore, and the different stats the animals have still have an impact on the way you're playing. It might not be the perfect animal simulation, but a fun animal-themed survival game nonetheless. A Dog's Life. In this game, you are the good dog. Your girlfriend gets captured by dog catchers and you have to find and save her. To do that, you have to chase chickens, fart and shit on the floor, but also literally sniff out clues and make allies. A huge part of the gameplay is going into Smell-O-Vision to see scent trails and then follow and collect them. By doing so, you trigger quests and minigames which award you with tasty dog bones that raise your level. Sadly, you're incentivized to spend a lot of time in first-person Smell-O-Vision, and so you can't really appreciate the hard work done by the devs to animate the canine protagonist. The game isn't much to look at, but it seems all the resources were put into modeling and animating the player character. The way he walks or turns around, the way he swims or interacts with the game world, and of course all the tricks he can perform. They really gave it their all to make this dog as authentic as possible. When roaming around a good number of diverse playgrounds, you can dig for bones, chase other dogs, pee everywhere, and growl or bark and bark and bark. Had this game been released today, it would have been more akin to Goat Simulator. I guess it's kinda like an ancestor to these goofing around sandboxes that were popular for a few days. A fun little game, despite it being a bit on the easy side, but it just captures the feeling of running around as a dog and finding a bunch of opportunities to cause mischief. And yes, you can get pet. Evo, Search for Eden. This game takes you through the history of our planet, well, kinda. You start 400 million years ago as the champion of our planet's soul, Gaia. Her plan for you is to lead you through all the major steps of evolution and defend the planet from dangerous invisible forces who meddle with the planet's course of evolution. You start the game as a fish, when life on land hasn't really developed yet. You can eat some seaweed for health and chomp down on jellyfish to get evolution points. You need those Evo points to stand a chance against bigger fish that can kill you in one or two bites. With Evo points, your character can develop stronger jaws or horns or scales or an actual thicker skin, better fins, and the more you progress in the story, the more options you get to evolve your character. After leaving the ocean, you become an amphibian, where you can evolve in a way that lets you jump higher, or one to be stronger. You have to help the other amphibians to survive by defeating giant insects that destroy all the plant life on the surface. After that, you can play as a dinosaur and have even more options to evolve. In addition to developing different jaws and tails and legs, you can now choose between a long and a short neck, bipedal or quadrupedal, and you can even develop wings to soar through the air. If you play your cards right, you may even evolve over time into an actual human. But that's not what we're here for. While fighting never gets more complicated than biting enemies or jumping on them, each of the many different animals you can create adds their own variety to the gameplay. Fish can freely move around in the water but don't have a jump attack, while birds have all the abilities of a land-living animal, just way slower, but can take flight to gain speed and evade enemies. Some animals are faster than others, some can jump higher, some can ram enemies, and some have a higher reach. The gameplay stays relatively simple throughout the game, but has a lot of nuances depending on which animal you play as. And I chose this game over something like Spore, because in Spore, half of the game wasn't about evolving a creature, but fighting as one of many alien humanoids over dominance in the universe. Whereas Evo, while still a bit weird, has you staying and more or less behaving like an animal until the end. It also has some similarities with Claymates, where you're not really an animal, but a boy who got turned into clay and can now assume the appearance of different animals and use their different abilities. So the mouse is quicker, but the cat can climb up trees and the bird is able to fly. The game is quite enjoyable, but not as complex as Search for Eden. So yeah, Evo is a pretty good choice for this list. Snake Pass. In Snake Pass, you play as a snake. And a bird. Yeah, try not to confuse it with snake bird. Your objective is to collect gems, called keystones, as well as coins and blue glowy thingies. And to collect those, you have to slither around the level, over and under obstacles, climb structures and hang from ledges. And it is so satisfying to move as a snake. The way Noodle, which is an awesome name for a snake by the way, is animated and how his body interacts with the environment. The way he wraps himself around poles, it feels and looks just right. Movement can be a bit finicky, but then again, that's the whole point of the game. That is where the challenge comes from. The game is a Slytherin simulator. Going straight is slow, but steering rhythmically left and right builds up speed. You can raise Noodle's head to crawl up ledges, but to really get up high, you have to carefully wrap around objects in the environment, stretch his body, and wrap around objects some more. Sometimes you can make things a bit easier by calling Doodle, the hummingbird, to grab Noodle's back end and lift it up. This can help when crawling up over some obstacles, but it won't save Noodle from plummeting to his death should he lose his grip, which is to be expected from such a little bird. The game, especially Noodle's animation, looks stunning, and the unique way this game controls has been a perfect choice for a game about a snake. The game can be challenging, but it's also very satisfying when everything clicks. Banjo-Kazooie. Who would have doubted that my favorite bear and bird duo made the top of the list? Rare was king of the mascot platformers during the 90s. They became famous, or more infamous, with Battletoads and conquered the Super Nintendo with Donkey Kong Country. They were so popular, they even made Miyamoto jealous. I was close to pick Donkey Kong Country 2 for this list, and if it weren't for my rule not to include more than one mascot character per studio, the whole DKC series would have been featured, same with Conker's Bad Fur Day, which subverted the whole mascot platform adventure genre. The game that impressed me the most, though, both with its main gameplay loop as well with its implementation of its animal characters, was Banjo-Kazooie. At the core, it's an objective-based 3D platformer in the vein of Mario 64, with a variety of open levels that function a bit as platforming sandboxes, all connected through a hub world. But instead of an incredibly athletic Italian plumber, we got this duo of bear and bird, with a more appropriate moveset. As a bear, Banjo is a bit slower and uses his massive fists to pummel his opponents. There is a certain weight to all his moves. Kazooie, on the other hand, is quick and light. Or at least she would be if she didn't have to carry Banjo. She pecks at enemies with her beak, and she can extend Banjo's jump by flapping her wings. She also later learns to actually fly, or to attack with eggs, which might not be realistic, but thematically appropriate for a bird. She can shield Banjo with her wings, and even the shoe upgrades she receives are in line with her design. She is fast, so she wears sneakers, and she has long legs, so she wears rubber boots. While swimming, Banjo paddles with his legs, but Kazooie uses her long wings to give a speed boost underwater. Health is represented by honeycombs, because bears love honey. Everything just fits together in this game. Great gameplay, awesome music, detailed and well-designed levels, and all of that carried by these iconic characters. You immediately grasp their strengths and weaknesses, and all their quirks and abilities feel intuitively right. It might not have the most complicated mechanics, but it still portrays its animalistic protagonists so incredibly well that there is no way around putting it at the top of this list. And if you have never played this awesome game, you owe it to yourself to do so right now. And if you have already played it, there's no reason why you shouldn't replay it right now. But what video game animal characters are your favorites? What are their abilities and how do they affect the gameplay? Tell me in the comments. Maybe you can recommend me something I didn't know before. And with that, I bid you adieu. That's it from Raidy. Have a great day and I hope to see you again on the next game.